And today's program is painting trees with the Hake Brush. And I'm going to do an on-location video and take you all the way through step by step. And this is the on-location painting I did. It's really an impressionistic painting, but I brought it back to the studio. I did a review. I made some painting changes, which I'll show. I made a new design, which I'll go over with you. A value study, which is very, very important. And then finally, I'll do a demonstration painting. Hi, this is Everett from Everett's Watercolors. Welcome to my classroom. I'm broadcasting live today. This is 2 o'clock p.m. on Eastern Standard Time on the East Coast. And I'm broadcasting to all across the United States and around the world. So welcome. If you're watching, also during the rebroadcast, make some comments, give me a thumbs up, and please subscribe to my channel and recommend my channel to any friends you have or people interested in art. I come on every Thursday at 2 o'clock p.m. I'm in my studio today with my wife, Gloria.
Hi, and that's 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's correct. Thank you. And I've got the chat room on, so you can put questions or comments on there, and Gloria will be monitoring the broadcast and also checking out my comments for me. Now, today, I'm going to be talking about, I'm going to do a plein air painting, at least a portion of it, and also I'm going to do a painting here in the studio. But I did a little quick video last weekend, and I think you'll find it interesting. I did a lot of painting with my Hake brush, and it's really versatile, and I think you'll find some interesting things that I did with that. And then we'll come back here to the studio, and we'll do some more, and I'll show you some other techniques. So without further ado, let me turn the video on, and I'll come back with you as soon as it's over. Now, here we are at Plein Air. This is my Plein Air site. You can see the beautiful trees I'm going to be painting today. And there's my setup with my my French easel and my canvas boards. And here's my composition thumbnail, which I did a quick sketch of my composition. And here I'm blocking in the outline of the design using yellow ochre with a round brush. And I'm using my thumbnail sketch that I did in pencil. And I'm outlining the shapes and the contours that I want to put on the canvas board. So here it's very important to get the scale and the size and the location. Here I'm sighting the angle, holding the brush out at arm's length and capturing the angle of, say, the edge of the road. And I'm moving that brush down on the canvas and capturing that angle. And over here, I've got some trees on the left-hand side border here. So I'm just putting in a little indication here where the trees are. Now, my focal point's going to be right there. That's where everything goes together, the roadway and the edge of the trees. And here, the blue sky, I'm adding a little bit of, I'm using cerulean blue with the Hake brush. And it's a very dry mix. I don't have a lot of water in the brush because I don't want it to run down the canvas. So it's just a damp brush with a little bit of cerulean blue. I just want to tone the background of the sky. Now, the middle ground trees is a lighter color, so I'm using I'm using green number one, a little bit of yellow mixed in, to give me a light green. So the middle ground trees have a light green area, so I'm going to capture the light areas first. So my light values go in first, and so the tree line here. This is in the middle ground tree line. I'm putting in the light value of those middle ground green trees. And so they'll shape that up there, and that'll give me a starting point for where to add on from there. Now, I'm really just capturing the impression here. Now, this there's also a tree over here, a bunch of trees over here on the left. And I'm going to put that in now using the same light value of green. So I'm putting in, again, I'm putting in all my light values first. First stage to get the light values in. And the Hake Brush gives me lots of control on the edges, where I can use it to get texture, showing the branches and so forth. And just by using the edge of the brush, the corner of the brush, gave me the shapes and the sizes of those trees. Now here we'll take a little long range view here from my easel, what I'm looking at. And zooming in on those light green trees, which I just put on the canvas. So those light trees are in the middle ground. So that's what I was trying to capture there on the canvas on stage one. Okay, and then off to the field at the right there, on the bottom of those trees, there's a brown, light brown field that I'm putting in now. And I'm using a mixture of lemon yellow and a little bit of burnt sienna. Lemon yellow, a little bit of yellow ochre. And now I'm putting in a little bit of burnt sienna to give a little bit of texture in the field. I'm using the edge of the Hake Brush and just stroking the paper, stroking the canvas with the burnt sienna to give me the little rough grass, brown grass that's in the field. Now here I'm capturing the grass that's on the edge of the field and the roadway, a little bit of green number one on the brush. And then I'm using the edge of the brush and I'm pushing down and scraping upward. It gave me the texture of grass. A little upward stroke at the bottom. Go at the start at the bottom, a little bit upward stroke, give me the look of grass. Off to the left now is there's pine trees over here also with these green trees. So I'm putting some pine needles here on the ground. And I'm using a mixture of burnt sienna, a little bit of alizarin crimson, because they've got a reddish brown look. So those are the pine needles on the ground. Now the background trees are going to be a little bit darker. So in the foreground, middle ground trees in the yellow, yellow green was the forward level. Now there's a background level of trees which are much darker. So I'm using a darker mix of green. I'm using actually Hooker's green, a little bit of ultramarine blue to give me a dark green. Now here up at the top, I'm using the corner of the brush, and I'm trying to capture some of those sky holes up there. So I'm leaving lots of little open areas there to put branches and so forth at the top of the tree line. So I'm using the corner of the brush and just tapping it there on the canvas. Now here's another, just a slow down view here, looking at this tree line. And I'm going to zoom in and get a close up of those nice light trees. And then I'm going to zoom in on that brown field and the roadway and take you into the focal point. And this is what I described. It's got a light and dark, and it's got lots of interest there. We got several items there that are pointing, the roadway, the trees, and the grass, all pointing in that direction. Okay, we're going back to the background trees again now with a little bit of a darker mix. Now I've got my favorite music in the background that's going to take us into the final part of this particular demonstration. So stand by. We'll be right back. Now we're going back to normal speed as we put the roadway in. And I'm using a mixture here of Payne's gray and a little bit of ultramarine blue. And with that Hake brush, it's just a beautiful stroke. Load up the brush with the paint and then just stroke it down, make a nice smooth direction. And I can put a little texture in there, but this is just a blacktop road, an old country road. So right after this demonstration, right here now, I'm going to take you back to the studio and we'll talk about the painting. Well, hey, we're back. Hey, wasn't that a great video? I really enjoyed painting outdoors. It was a beautiful day. And of course, the lighting is always changing. And finally, at the end there, I got a nice view there of the nice sun coming in, a nice little shadow pattern and so forth. And but anyway, I really enjoyed the painting. I hope you enjoyed that. I added a few new things on there. So I'm going to take you over to my painting table and let's talk about the painting a little bit. And I'm going to show you something else I did and give you a little demonstration. So let's go over to my, I'm going to put you on my painting table.
Let's see.
Okay, now this is a painting I did out. This is a painting I did on location. And I made it, when I came back to the studio, I did some additional things here. On the tree line here, I broke up the shapes a little bit. You can see here, I went with a smaller brush, kind of broke up those light green areas here in the foreground. And that's about all I did. As far as just touching out. Oh, and I also lifted with the canvas. It's very easy to lift the paint off of this. I can demonstrate that to you very quickly. But I lifted out the tree trunks there on the trees. Let me bring up a little bit closer so you can see that. I lifted out the tree trunks and I broke up those tree shapes a little bit with just taking out some of the paint off the canvas. So that's the one. I would call this an impressionistic painting. Impressionistic painting. I really am an impressionistic artist, and I really like this to capture the essence and to capture the shape and the location. All right, let's put this aside. Okay, let's go over some things. Also, when I got back to the studio, I printed out, I had taken some pictures while I was out there on location. And really here, let me show you, this is really a panorama. These are three pictures that I took that I kind of put together here to show you the full scope. It was quite a scene I had of all those trees and everything. So you can see here, the impact area down here with this nice roadway down into the nice, leading right into this little trail and so forth, the end of the road. But what I did was I started looking at the tree line. I said, well, in order for me to paint that in a demonstration today in class, I said, that's too much to paint. So what I did is I went in, I isolated down a section of the trees here, this section about right here. Let me show you what I did. So I took this picture. And I isolated the scene down to this row of trees right here, from right here to here. So the first thing I did was, there's the picture. That's the picture I isolated down. I took it, took that section and put it on Photoshop, and I just went and cropped it out. And that's the section I'm going to demonstrate today. And what I did was I went ahead and I did a drawing from that photo. That's the reference photograph for today's painting in class. And this is the drawing from this particular picture. This is my drawing. And I actually put in the tree trunks and everything else in there, okay? Now, before we go any further, let me show you some things here. I'm going to put you on my close-up camera. Not close-up, I'm going to use it. Okay. What I have here now on all the supplies and everything I use today in today's demonstration are on my website, everettswatercolors.com. And our supplies, also the classroom videos are there for a rerun to go on to my Facebook, or my website. And the Funnel Watercolor is where you can download the photograph I just showed you that I'm going to use today. And here's the QR code right here. This is the EverettsWatercolors.com. This is my website. And you just take your cell phone and you take your camera and go up here and focus in on this one section, and bam, it'll take you right to my website. And you can go here and look at the supplies, look at the videos, and also look at the Fun with Watercolors and download the photograph and the drawing. Also here, I'm going to show here my Facebook group, which is Everest Watercolors Art Group. And here's also a QR code for this. Again, you focus here with your camera on your cell phone or with your iPad, and it'll take you right into the Facebook page, Everest Watercolors Art Group. So I thought this would be simpler today to show you that. And go ahead and zoom in. I'll hold up there. You can take a snapshot of that and zoom right in. Okay, let me put that aside. Okay, now, first thing I did, once I did my, let me take you back to the painting table. So I took the photograph here, and I took the drawing. But then I did a value study. And I think what really turned out from that value study, from the value plan, is very unique. So what I found out was that when I started putting in the values, I came with an very interesting pattern with those tree trunks and with the tree masses of trees. So this is what I really, really, really enjoyed. I picked out those trees from the photograph, and I didn't follow exactly. I went ahead and I used some of the tree trunks there, but then I went ahead and designed my own pattern here, what I thought would be the way to do this painting. All right. So this is really my painting plan. This value study here is my painting plan. And you can do the same thing. You can take the photograph I did here, and you can do your own value plan or your own value plan, and then go from there. So start out with a good sketch. Study the values you want to do. Where's your lights and darks, and what's the pattern? So that is really the key to today's painting I'm going to show you. Let me put this aside. So the photograph and the drawing are on my Fun with Watercolor page on my website. And I hope you do download that. I'd like to have some of you that are interested, I'd like to have you try that and put it on my Facebook page. And so we can talk about it. I'd like to look at it, give you some comments, and get a conversation going. Okay, well, what I've done in preparation, I've gone ahead and transferred the drawing to a quarter sheet of watercolor paper. This is Gemini watercolor paper, 140-pound cold press. Very good water paper. Again, I have this on my website. And what I did, I went in and I masked in with masking fluid the tree trunks. You can see that they're marked in blue. And I used the masking fluid. This is the Holbein brand masking fluid. Okay. So I masked out the tree trunks on the sketch. And what I did with my colors now, I'm going to mainly use the blue. There's a lot of greens in this painting. So it's going to be a lot of yellows and blues. So I took my lemon yellow paint, and I mixed it with cobalt. Here's a mixture right here. Let me bring this up on the close-up camera. You'll see it much better. So I'll take it to a close-up camera. And what you see here is this first mix here is the cobalt blue and yellow lemon. You can see it gives me a lighter green, a nice bright green. Then I mixed ultramarine deep with the lemon yellow, and I get a little darker value, maybe a middle value. And then I have a royal blue in my palette, royal blue, and I mix that with lemon yellow, and I get a very dark green. Now, if I want to go darker than that, I can go with Payne's gray, mix it with yellow, and I can come up with a dark green there also. Different, kind of a different value or different color green. And also I mixed it, I lightened it up just a little bit here, just with just to show you that I could just, this is green number one. This is green number one out of my palette. But it's a different looking green. If you look at that color, it's not as natural as this. This has got a more natural color with a mix. The mixture of blue and green, blue and yellow, gives you a much nicer green than the one out of the, this is my green number one, which is my lightest green. My green number two, again, it's pretty close to this one, but this is a much more interesting looking green than this. This is out of the palette. And my Hooker's green is dark. It's very close to the royal blue and the lemon yellow, very close to that. So Hooker's green, this is the dark green. So these are the greens I have on my rail on my palette. These are the mixtures of green with yellow and blue. I went one step further. The complement to green, if you look at the color wheel, complement of green is red. And I'm going to use alizarin crimson with the green to give me a little another mixture of the green. It dulls it down, but it also changes the color of green a little bit. It mutes it down a little bit. So again, it gives me another value, another color change with the green mixture. So this is just a little touch of alizarin crimson with each one of those colors. And I did it here also. And also used yellow ochre. I put yellow ochre in here with a little bit of that green. In other words, I want to get a mixture of everything possible that I could use for this particular painting. So over here is yellow ochre. And over here is alizarin crimson. So I played around with the mixtures here with the different colors of yellows and blue, yellows and blues to get the greens, and also played around with adding yellow ochre and adding alizarin crimson. Okay, so those are my color mixes.
Can you position that so they can take a screenshot?
Okay, I'm going to hold it right there, so it'll be on the video. You can see that, and you can also take a screenshot. Okay, all right, let's go back to the painting table camera. All right, we'll put that aside. So it's before you start painting, you need to come up with a little idea of the colors you're going to use, and play around with the mixes and get the mixes that you like. Now I'm going to come over to my palette now. And I'm going to be using the Hake brushes today. I got a large Hake, my small Hake, but I also got another Hake. I'm really going to have three of them eventually. I got these two here on my website. I'm playing around with a smaller Hake here. So I have a large, medium, and small Hakes. So I'll be using these two here and this one a little bigger for the trees. So I'll be using the Hake brush here using it with paper. Also be using the Holbein synthetic brushes. I got a 3/4 inch flat, or a 1/2 inch, and a number 6 round. These three brushes here I'll be using from. These are Holbein synthetic brushes, which I use. Now, along with the Hake, I have a towel. I've got a terry cloth towel used. I use that to take the water out of the. After you wet the brush, I'm using your plain water, and then I pat the towel. That takes the excess moisture out of the brush, because that Hake holds a lot of water. Even when I was in plain air, I had a towel in my hand, and as I was going from mixture to mixture, I made sure I took the excess water out before I went to the canvas. Those of you, I could show you very quickly here. Now here's a small piece of canvas. Now, what I did on that plein air was I took a plain brush. This is a number 6 round. And I put a little bit of water in it, just plain water. And I went ahead and just with water. And I took a tissue after I wet it and blotted it up. And that's how easy it is to take the paint off canvas, just like that. Just put a little water on it. Take a tissue and blot. That's all I had to do. Okay. So I thought that's how I did that. It took the paint off the canvas. We just used a little bit of water with a small brush. Okay. Well, today, though, we're going to use watercolor paper, 140 pound, and we're going to use brushes, I mean, the paint out of the palette. So first I'm going to do, I'm going to mix up my colors. I'm going to start with a sky like I did in the demonstration. I'm going to use cerulean blue. Don't need that much.
We have a question. Can you do the same thing on watercolor paper, on the lifting on the canvas?
No. No. There's the lifting. I'll show you some lifting on the paper also. Basically, you wet it, but then you don't use the, you don't lift it with a tissue. You have to rub it with a towel. It's the same sort of thought about it, but it's a little different procedure. With canvas, what happens with canvas is the paint is not absorbed into the canvas. It lays on top of the canvas, so it's easy to take off. As a matter of fact, once you do watercolor on canvas, you got to be very careful. You don't put any water around it. It'll take it right off. So what I do is I spray with acrylic spray after I'm finished, and that preserves the watercolor. So I'm mixing up a little bit, just watering down a little bit of this. I'm using cerulean blue for the sky. Right now, my first step would be to take the large Hake, a little bit of water. I'm going to just wet the sky a little bit, just get a little star here. Lubricate the paper a little bit with some water. Okay, then I'm going to take the middle Hake, the smaller Hake. I'm going to pick up some of that paint, pick up the paint out of the palette. This is a cerulean blue. And then I'm going to put that sky color in. And I want it to be a light value. I don't want it to be very dark. With that water on the paper and then just a light wash here with the brush. So I'm just putting a little sky color up here as a background. So that's the cerulean blue, and I can just come on down until it runs out of, there we go. Just let it kind of blend down. And now I'm going to pick up a little bit. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take the 3/4 inch brush, and I'm going to mix up a little bit of, I don't need any more cerulean. Take that out. So I'll remove that from the palette. It gives me some more room. So pick up a paper towel and remove that. I'm going to put a little bit of ultramarine blue. This is ultramarine blue now. I'm going to use a lot of blues today. So I'm going to take a little bit of the alizarin crimson and mix it in with that. I want to get a nice purple. Nice purple color. More on the blue side, but I want to be a little bit of red in it, just give me a little purple. And I'm gonna, while this is still wet up here, I'm just gonna put a little bit of cloud, up here in the sky. Just to give me some, instead of just having a plain old sky up here, just put a little more interest up there. Do a little cloud formation up in the background. It's gonna, that'll dry, it'll dry lighter, and that's all I want. So just an idea of a sky. Okay, let that dry. All right, now what I think all I'll do now is I'll put the blow dryer on. Okay, so we put the cerulean blue, very light, with just a little bit of water on top to do a background sky. Then I mixed up a little bit of purple with ultramarine blue and alizarin crimson, make a little purple. Just give me a little cloud. Give me a little cloud color up there in the sky. Now I want this dry because I'm going to be putting some trees here on top of this. I'm going to dry this color. Now when I was outdoors, plein air, it dried pretty fast on the canvas because I was outside with a little bit of sunshine and the wind blowing on the canvas. It dried very quickly. But I did basically the same steps that I'm doing here, except I'm doing it on paper. And I thought doing this demonstration, I thought you could see the two ways I'm painting. I'm painting on canvas in one location, and I'm painting on paper here. So it's a little bit different media as far as paper and canvas, but it makes it very interesting. All right, so the first thing I'm going to do now, I'm going to mix up a a light color here for the light background trees. So I'm going to use a little bit of cobalt blue now. Cobalt blue. So now I'm using a little bit of cobalt blue, and I'm going to mix it. I'm using the half inch brush to do my mixes. Because if I don't, I'll get the brush all mixed up with different colors. So I'm going to use the. Now this first wash of color is going to be, it's going to be green, but it's going to be more on the blue side. Because as trees are further away, they tend to be a little bit, to give it the impression of depth, they're a little bit bluer. So I'm going to take advantage of that. So I'm going to indicate the far away trees, the background trees, to have a little more blue into the mix. I'll make sure I have enough here. I'm going to be covering that whole top. The whole top portion up there. Okay, now I'm going to wet my my medium brush, my medium Hake brush, take out all the excess water, and just pick up the color. I'm going to go in now and put in that background tree line, which is up in the sky. And I'm going to come down just a little ways, because these are the background. These are really way off in the background. Way up, they're up high and way off in the background. So that's also how I planned this painting. I said, well, there's really actually three layers of trees. There's a background layer way, way back. Then there's a middle ground layer. And then there's a little foreground layer of trees. So that's kind of the way I designed this painting, was to do it in three layers, back, middle, and forward. Okay. Now I think I'll pick up a little bit more of that cobalt blue. I'll pick it up now with a Hake now, a little bit of Hake into my palette, a little bit more blue in that mixture. Go back here and I'm going to get the edge a little bit dark. I want the edge to be a little bit darker than the sky. So I'm putting a little more pigment back there on that skyline. Just to separate the tree from the sky to be a little bit darker in value. And the other thing I want to do also is while I'm doing this is I go along. Every time I go into the palette, I'm going to change colors. I don't want to use the same color. I had to pick up a little bit of yellow there just to add with that blue, change that. All right, now I'm going to blow dry that. Okay, so these background trees are further back, and they got more blue in them. Got a bluer tone to them. And their light value, the lighter value, and they've got more blue in the mixture. It's still green. I mixed a little bit of yellow with that cobalt to give it a green, but it's going to have a more greenish flavor to it. Okay. All right. Now the next mixture I'm going to use, a little darker green. So I'm going to pick up Ultramarine. I'm going to use ultramarine blue now. And I'm going to pick up a little bit of yellow green or lemon yellow. So let me mix that with a paintbrush, because if I put my, what happens if I put the Hake into my palette here, it's going to mix up the colors, and I don't want to do that. So I'm going to mix it right here on the palette. I can control the smaller brush for mixing. Now I want to get the right color I'm looking for. Let's see. So So here's where the alizarin crimson comes in. All right, I got the right value. I want it to be a little bit darker, but it's too green. It's too green. So how do I mellow that down? How do I make the change to make it a little bit less green? Well, I add its complement, which is going to be alizarin, which is red, which is alizarin crimson. And I don't need that much, just a little touch. A little touch of red goes a long way. But that will change that green now to a muted green or an intermediate green. It won't be exactly green as green. Okay, that's what I'm looking for. All right. Perfect. Okay, now I also have a little test paper here that does. Now that was the green by itself, and then I went and added a little bit of red to it, and you can see the tone, how it's changed a little bit. It's a little bit duller, a little bit muted. Okay, now I'm going to rinse out my brush because I don't want that old paint in there, and rinse it out, put it out on the... Okay, I'll go into the palette, load up my medium paint brush. Now I'm going to go in now and put in the... I'm going to use a little more kind of a end of the end straw. I want to look a little bit more like trees now. I'm going to start playing with the brushwork now. So I can use the end of the brush. I want to be a little more definition now of that brush stroke. So I'm going to use a little bit more of the end brush. I'm using the end of the brush, a little bit of corner of the brush. And as I go back in now, I'm going to pick up some more color, but I'm changing the color a little bit. I'm going to put a little more paint in there. So I'm changing color. I'm not going to use the same color I did before. So I go back to the palette. I'm going to change the color. Now I'm trying to show us a little more definition here now of these trees, as far as the corner is concerned. The edges will have a little sharper edge to them. And I'm also changing the slope of them. Now here I got a couple of these taller trees. I'm going to make sure I got a little definition here. The edges of an object defines it much better than anything else. And the edges of a tree is always rough. There are very few trees that have a smooth edge. Now my brush is getting my brush is getting drier and drier now. But just a touch of water now, just a touch, don't need much. I'm gonna pick up a little bit more of that blue, just a touch. I'm changing the color slightly. Loading the brush. Now I'm going back in. That's gonna change that color slightly. I overlap a little bit. I want to stop and start too. I want to go gradually change, not drastic. Okay, then I'm going to come off here to the end. Make this up a little bit more here. Okay, now I'm going to mix up another color. Now, so I've got the kind of, you see the change, the color changes already. I've got color changes. So the next mix I'm going to make, I'm going to use... Now I'm going to use the same mix. I'm going to use ultramarine blue, but this time I'm going to add a lot more yellow to it. So the mixture now has become more yellow as I get closer. So as you come closer in the landscape, the green gets a little brighter because it's closer. You can see the colors better. In fact, you saw some of those trees in the photographs in the movie I did. Those foreground the trees that were forward were a lot greener than the ones in the middle area and in the background. So here I'm going to add a lot more yellow to this. And it's a pretty big area I want to cover, so I'm going to bring this in real. Okay. Okay, now here's where we can become a little more experimental, not experimental, a little artistic. Load the brush. Build some paint on my paper. Just be careful. All right, now in here, I'm going to come in with, this is a lighter mix now, so the color is going to come out a little bit different. And I'm going to use basically the same. I'm just going to cover the paper very quickly. But I want to, what I want to do here, though, is I want to change the color. So I'm going to pick, there's a little bit of yellow deep, which is right next to lemon yellow. I'm going to pick that up a little bit. I'm going to put that in there. So I just changed color from my palette. So I just add a little color to the mix here. So as I come across here on this particular pass, the color is not only going to be lighter, but I'm going to have different color changes. I'm going to pick up a little bit of burnt sienna. Because some of the trees had some brown leaves on them. So I'm going to pick up a little bit of burnt sienna. I'm going to put that in there. Go back to that green. I like that green mix. So I like that green mixture. I'm taking a lot of water out of my brushes before I go down on the paper. So I'm changing color again. I don't want the same color going all the way across. I modify the color, going back to a little more of the green. And I'll pick up a little bit more yellow out of my palette. And I'll put that in some areas. I want little places of yellow. Because there's a lot of yellow contrast in there, along with that green. A lot of yellow. Now, as I come up here to the end, I'll be a little bit duller on this side, on the edges. Because this is not the real focal point. And I really don't have a focal point on this one. It's it could be. We'll find one. But we could find one if we look hard enough. Okay. So, I modified it, and I'm going to dry that also. Let it dry for a little while. So while it's drying a little bit before we get to it, let's mix up the next color. Now there's a shadow pattern across the bottom. That's really what I'm going to do here. Let's pick it up. Let's pick this up now with clean out the palette just a little bit. We got a lot of paint in here, so let me take the sponge and pick up this porcelain palette. It's very easy to clean. Just take a sponge and pull it out. I painted with a plastic palette for many, many years, and I finally bought a porcelain palette, and it's much easier to clean out. Okay, now what I'm going to do here now is use that same color. I'm going to start with the ultramarine blue, but then I'm going to mix a lot more. I'm going to take a alizarin crimson, darken it up. I'm going to take a little bit of burnt sienna, darken it up. And I'm even going to take some Hooker's Green, darken it up. And I'll pick up some Royal Blue. Royal Blue is my darkest color in my palette, along with Payne's Gray. So Payne's Gray will be another color I can mix in there. Okay, so I got a lot of dark color in there. Now I'm going to take my my 3/4 inch flat. I'm going to stay with a Hake. Okay, I'm going to load up my brush. Wash out my color. I had a lot of yellow in there. So I'm going to pick up this dark paint. Load up the brush. Okay, now I'm going to go in here now. And I'm going to put this shadow pattern on the bottom. From the ground on up. Now as I go across, I'm going to pick up color now. Here's some burnt sienna. I'm going to stick that in there. That's a little bit of brown in there. Then I'm going to pick up some alizarin crimson, a little bit of red. So I'm going to have a color change as I go across here. Then I'll pick up a little bit more of my ultramarine blue. I can even pick up a little bit more of Hooker's Green. So I have some green in there also. So I got quite a very colorful shadow pattern on the bottom of this. And I'll go back here to the mixture I had and go in and kind of put that in the sections that I want to. So I'm kind of break it up a little bit so it doesn't all look the same. That's my whole objective here, is not to make it look the same. I want it to be different all the way across. I want it to be dark because it's a shadow underneath the trees. Okay. All right, I'm going to let that dry. I don't have to go in there right now. Just let that dry a little bit. So I'm going to put the field in. Now, if you remember in the video, I just mixed up a little bit of yellow ochre, which I'm going to do here the same thing. Let me clean up some of this paint off the bottom here. Give me a little room. So I'll clean out my Hake brush, put it in water, and then squeeze it on the towel. Rinse it out in the bucket. Then I'll squeeze it in a towel. All right, I'm going to pick up a little bit of lemon yellow with a little water, just a little, make a nice and loose, nice loose combination. And then pick up a little bit of yellow ochre right here right next to it. Now I'm going to go ahead and put in the yellow field or the brown field. Some more yellow ochre. So this was the brown grass that was in the field, and that'll be green in the summertime because they sow vegetables in there. They put beans in there. I don't know if it's soybeans, what are they, but they put in greenery. Oh, so in the summertime that'll be a green field when before they're finished with it. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and put this all the way across. This gave a nice color to the bottom of the painting. I had all this green up here in the top of the painting, and I had this nice brownish, yellowish bottom of the painting, and it really made a nice change. I didn't have all greens. Even though this is a green painting with a lot of trees, you can see I have a lot of color in here. And then I'll pick up a little bit of that. Well, it's still wet. I'll pick up a little bit of burnt sienna. Just get the tip of the brush. And I'm going to put some of those strokes here in the. And all I do is just tap the paper. I don't need that much. There's not much paint on the paper, on the brush. I'll put those little groups of little rows of weeds and so little brown grass here was in the field. And that's all I do is just tap the brush on the paper while it's still wet. There, that's enough. And then this little corner piece down here, I'll put a little bit of, I'll use my three-quarter brush. I got ultramarine, I'll put a little bit of burnt sienna with that. That'll give me a gray. If you watched many of my videos, you'll know that I make my gray out of ultramarine and burnt sienna. That's my gray color. So I'll go down here and make that gray road right along the edge of the field here. And it went right. That was a nice part of that video I showed was putting in the roadway because it was a nice little way to end up the painting. A nice little quiet little scene there. Okay, now I'm gonna dry this with a blow dryer. Okay, so I've got the block in now. Blocked in the tree lines that I wanted to do little different colors of green, starting with a light dull green and a little brighter green here at the bottom. And then a shadow along the bottom of the trees. And this nice yellow brown field down here.
So now, you know, as you go along, and this is a work of art. It's just something you go along and you try, you practice what you're doing. And then you just try different things.
And one of the things I did, and I forgot to do it here, was as I was going along, I was spraying in a little bit of spray bottle. I'll show you another painting I did. So while it was still wet, I just hit the little spray bottle with water in it, and that gave me some texture up in the trees. That's something else to do. And then also what I can do is take a brush. And what I'll do is I'll block off the painting a little bit. What I did is block off this section here and block off the sky section with another towel. And I'll take the 3/4-inch brush here. I'll put a little bit of green on my brush, Then I'll stand up above here and I'll just tap it. And this way it'll give me a little texture. It'll give me the look of leaves, individual leaves. And there were some you could see here at the bottom. So I'll just tap it in, pick up, load the brush some more, a little bit of green on the brush, a little bit of dark green. And then just tap it in and get some leaf. That breaks up those patterns so they're all one solid color. Now they got a little bit of texture in there. So a little bit of spray bottle while it's still wet. I did it a little bit too late when it was dry, but I'll show you one where I've done it before. And then a little bit of splatter on top of that. Okay, now I need to dry that some more now. Okay, one more dry.
I'm picking up the extra water. I put water on there, but it takes too long to dry the water out. I'm picking it off of the tissue. As I get to my last step here, and then I'll show you another part of another painting I did that's finished. It's got to be dry because I'm going to take the masking fluid off, so the paper has to be perfectly dry. You don't want to tear the paper. Making sure all the moisture, picking up all the extra drops of water I see. I'm drying the paper real well. Okay, all right. The next step now is once I get to this point here, then I take the rubber cement pickup, which is a piece of rubber, and it's designed to take off the masking fluid. Then I'll take the masking fluid off just by rubbing over the paper. And this is why it's got to be perfectly dry, because if it wasn't, it would start tearing the paper underneath. Because the paper, you know, it's very fragile when it's wet. When it's wet, you don't want to mess too much pressure on it, or else you'll destroy the paper, especially if you're rubbing hard like this on there. You want to make sure the paper is dry. Once it's dry, you can take off this masking fluid. And you can see here I've left the white paper showing now. This is the tree trunks. And this came, I did this from that value study I did. When I did the value study, I said, wow, that's the most interesting part of this. I mean, the trees are fun and all that kind of stuff. I said, but really, what I really liked was the pattern of the tree trunks. They really fascinated me, the different design and the angles and so forth and the sizes. So that's what really got me started on this design, was to look at the... When I did a value study, I said, wow. Okay, now what I'm going to do now, I'm going to show you how I did the next step. I'm going to take a couple sections here, just show you how I did it from here. Then I'll show you the final result on another painting. Here, what I did is I mixed up some dark. Because if you look at that value study, you look at the photograph, there are dark areas. The value study here, all these dark areas are shadows behind the trees, but with the trunks that showed out. Okay, so that was really my painting plan right there. So what I'm going to do is just show you how I did that, what I did here to make it work. And I think it turned out really nice. So what I did here, the parts that are in shadow, don't worry about. It's the ones here that are up here in the middle ground that you have to. So let's take a section here. Let's start right here. So what I'm, this one here is in shadow. So I'm going to put the paint along the edge of the white. And I'm going to kind of, now this is what I call negative painting. What you're doing, you're negatively painting around the shapes here. So you're carving out the branches or the foliage that is behind the trunk. So what I do is I've darkened on each side of the tree trunk. And then I played with the shape of the foliage next to it. So it's a little bit of design practice, but it's also a practice in negative painting. So I'm building a leaf pattern around each one of these little white areas that I have. Come down here on this one, and it turned really fascinating. It took me a while to practice on this one, but it took a little practice, but I got better at it as I kept trying. And it's like anything, something that's hard the first time, it gets better as you practice working on it and trying different things. That's how you improve, by practice. So I played around with this and I come out with an interesting design. I'm going to show you one here, which I finished. But I'm going to show you what I did. I went in and I carved out. I used the tree trunks as the ones that were showing. And then behind, I showed the shadow behind those tree trunks. And I designed a pattern of a tree shape, of the leaves and so forth. And that's how I started doing this. I just started designing it from I did the value plan. And I said, wow, I can do something with that. Now this one, let me show you right here. This is where it really starts to be interesting at this point here. You can see this, the little curve, there's a little break up in here, but here I can see a flow. I see a flow across here of a tree line, a bunch of trees. And what I'm doing here is all I'm doing is just kind of designing that shape of that tree line. I don't want it to be straight. I want it to be irregular. So I'm building up around those white areas I have that I saved with the white paper. And then I'm building the little shapes of the trees around that. So this is really a good exercise in negative painting. This little section here, there's little trees behind here with the tree trunks peeping out. So that's what I did all the way across. I just picked little patterns. I made little patterns out of a section here. I made a little section there and just made a little pattern of trees. This little section right here, just by painting a negative shapes around. Okay. And then I can go back and I did a couple of things that I did also. Okay, I'm going to put this aside and I'm going to show you one that I finished, or more or less finished up to a certain point. So think about what I did here. Now I'm going to take it to the next phase. Okay. All right. Now here's a more completed example. Let me put a mat board around this. Now you can see here what I did. All I did here was I designed the shapes of the trees around these tree trunks, and up here I added some dark branches up here in this just lower this tree here and put some darker branches back here. Okay. So the light branches really define the tree. And then I just went in and did a negative paint. You see the tree, the trees that go across here, and you see the different colors and so forth that show up. So that turned out to be a very, very interesting way to paint. I've never done one like this before. Let me bring it up. Now, a couple of things. There's some more things that can be worked on this. And you can see here, you can see the spray bottles. The spray bottles gave me this little irregular pattern up here in the top. That's from the spray bottles. And the splatter, you can see the splatter of the tree, of the little marks on it. You can see the splatter in the branches on those lower trees. That was from the splatter. Okay. Let's see. Let me take my, where's my, I got one. I wanted to show you something else on the actual painting I did out Plein Air. Now here's the Plein Air one. Now what I did here, in order to break up, you can see the trees there, the trees. So I did something like this. And then here I actually took a palette knife and put it in the paint and just rubbed it across there. And it gives you an irregular pattern on top of that. You can see that. Let me take some of this paint. I'm just putting wet paint on the bottom of a palette knife. And I can drag that across. I'll get an irregular pattern. And I got plenty of palette knives here. Here's a smaller one. I scraped it across there, and I can get different effects. So that's what I did. That's what I did with these leaves across the trunks here. I just went ahead with a palette knife, and I left some irregularities in there, and that's how I did that part. Okay. That's a little bit better. If I took a brush, it would have covered up too much. But by taking the palette knife over there, it kind of skips around because it's not a solid paintbrush. Okay, so there's a couple of techniques I did. Don't forget the spray bottles. Don't forget the splatter, and taking out the negative painting. So there's lots of stuff. Now here on this one, I could go in and make some changes to the tree trunks. I can make some of them a little bit different colors, but I don't want to play. I don't want to do any more touches on this one. But I could go in and put some color on these tree trunks. I could make some of them darker or different colors. And I could look at where is a focal point. And I think an area that might be interesting would be right here. This section in here might be interesting. Or this is kind of in the middle of the painting. Maybe this area right here might be the best one. It's got more interest. It's got more shapes. And it's got some different trees and different branches and so forth. So this might be a good area for this area right here might be a good area for an impact area right here. Okay, if you need an impact area. And so this one turned out pretty good. I really like this one. Okay, so let's go back over to my main camera. All right. Alrighty. Come into the main camera. Hey. Well, I hope you saw some different things on that particular painting there. Not just the plein air demonstration, but when I put that value plan together and I started playing around with the negative shapes, the darks and lights, that's when the light bulb came on. I said, wow, I need to paint it that way. So I concentrated more on the tree trunks than I did on the actual foliage. I painted all the foliage in, different colors and different values and all that stuff. But then the real icing on the cake was to put that negative shapes in behind the tree trunks. And I think that's what really makes the painting come alive, is that contrast between the lights and darks. And the pattern of the tree trunks themselves. So that painting was really based upon pattern and also on value. Well, I hope you enjoyed that, and I'd like to hear some comments, and give me some likes, and give me some thumbs up. And if you haven't subscribed, please subscribe to my YouTube channel, so that you'll hear about my videos from coming in the future. So
So thank you for watching, and I'll be back again next week on Thursday, 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. So until I see you the next week.